Got a spike on the RWR. Strange PRF.
What's wrong?
Control lost. Can't maintain RPM. We're settling.
Such a lust for revenge! Who?
Thank you.
Cypher will rewrite the records, and I will vanish from human memory. But the thirst for revenge that I have planted will infest the system! No one can stop it now! Sahalanthropus will unleash that thirst unto the future! Major... I'm burning up!
Boss, get out of there! Sahalanthropus! Boss, stop Sahalanthropus. Destroy that thing. I'll rally Diamond Dogs and provide backup.
About this OKB-0 Emmerich was talking about. Its location and features match the citadel in the mountains northeast of the Soviet base camp. Built during the time of Alexander the Great, it was left in ruins following one of Genghis Khan's campaigns. Its occupants changed time and again due to war, and it was expanded on more than one occasion. Ultimately, it fell into the hands of the Soviet philosophers. The Soviet army was using it as the headquarters of its Afghan invasion force. But it would seem that Skullface's connection...
Great job.
...license to develop Sahalanthropus there.
Nice work.
That's what Emmerich was doing at the place, before he got the axe. But AKB is the designation the Soviets use for weapon design bureaus. There's no way they'd have one of those in Afghanistan. And, in principle, the numbers that follow OKB are always integers above one.
Supply drop! Hurry!
Perhaps this was a secret facility of the Soviet and Chinese philosophers dating back prior to World War II. Though it's more likely Skullface just picked a fake name that more or less fit the Soviets' pattern. He doesn't go there often, but he sure as hell won't miss this. They use the heliport on top of the tower for his visits. Start by heading for the heliport, then wait for your chance to make contact with Skullface.
It seems Sahalanthropus' armor is made from depleted uranium. That offers some serious protection. The U.S. military is planning on using it for its main battle tanks, too. Maybe that's where Emmerich got the technology.
Uranium? They're using nuclear fuel.
Nice work. Keep it up.
What they use for nuclear fuel is uranium-235, which is extracted from natural uranium. Depleted uranium is a byproduct of that process. Sort of like the leftovers, I guess.
Nice work.
Uranium-235 makes up 0.72% of natural uranium, whereas depleted uranium contains only 0.2%.
What are the benefits of using it?
It's a pretty short list. Uranium's a heavy metal, like lead. meaning it can hold a greater amount of kinetic energy. But it also boasts a hardness closer to tungsten that makes it an ideal material to use for, say, armor-piercing ammunition penetrators. But it's not the best choice for armor. Its volume is less than that of some
pretty good.
You could end up with less protection.
So why use it then?
According to Emmerich, it came down to him being unable to source ceramics technology from a manufacturer. Plus, given that it's an upright walking vehicle,
use this!
Despite all that, depleted uranium still makes for some tough armor. And Emmerich says it's been proven in live fire tests. It stops most Soviet tank shells.
Watch out, boss!
Go, Tucker. What are the metallic archaea?
Volcanic craters. Spewing sulfur.
It's coming after hours. Take it out.
Enough to boil your skin off. Ocean depths of 800 plus atmospheres. Wastelands radioactive enough to kill you where you stand. Groups of organisms that...
They shot down the chopper. Already a backup chopper. Call it from your iDroid.
I'm living in such environments.
I've heard about them. Extremo... something.
Extremophiles. By selecting certain species, then subculturing and repeatedly modifying them, I created a metallic offspring of pure archaea. They subsist on metals rather than organic matter.
And some of them even consume uranium?
Yes. Uranium enrichment archaea metabolize only uranium-235. As a result, they produce weapons grade.
Nearly there, Snake.
How is that possible? Consider how plants fractionate carbon isotopes when they conduct photosynthesis. Nature possesses abilities beyond our imagination.
So it was archaea that brought down your chopper?
Corrosive archaea, yes. They oxidize metals, feeding off the energy in the electrons they receive. What became of the wreckage?
We had the R&D team retrieve samples for study in airtight plastic containers, of course.
Prudent. We shall extract archaea from it in good time. They should help you fight back against Black Amano.
Any chance we could start now? It doesn't have to be a lot. I might just have another use for it.
If it's only a small amount you need.
That's fine. I'll get the R&D team to assist. Let's go.
South Africa was previously suspected of developing nuclear weapons. It already had a conspicuous presence in the UN because of apartheid and its armed expansionism. But when neighboring Angola and Mozambique became socialist countries in 74, South Africa felt hounded into a corner. So it accelerated its nuclear program to protect itself. 3 years later, the Soviets discovered a test facility. And 2 years after that, an American satellite observed a flash in the southern Indian Ocean. It said this was South Africa conducting a nuclear test with the help of a certain ally. Skullface used the situation...
Supply drop! Hurry!
...to get his ally to lend a hand. They both wanted nukes, so it was a mutually beneficial relationship. On the surface, anyway.
I figure South Africa started getting serious about nuclear weapons production in 75. In 74, the government was still able to get by with bluffing that it had a nuclear arsenal. But the year after... word spread that an independent armed group in the Caribbean was crushed by Cypher for possessing a WMD. That's right, boss. What happened to you and your men was the reason South Africa decided to push ahead with nuclear development. A force independent of any country getting its hands on a nuke. That was a threat to the existence of countries everywhere. It wasn't just South Africa. Your presence pushed a lot of countries to get nukes. The world was scared of you. You were a threat to more than just the Cold War. If nations are gears in a machine, you had the power to smash them loose and watch the whole world grind to a halt. Emmerich uses externally powered legs of his own design. It's bionics technology, a product of the U.S. military's failed attempt to develop a powered exoskeleton.
Great job.
All Air has to do is apply a little force, and the actuators continue the movement in that direction. But his legs are unique. Instead of using a hydraulic mechanism, the actuators run off metallic archaea.
That's the way.
Actuator's reaction speed and also enables him to lock and release the joints at will. The legs are a nifty little gadget, but they have two clear weaknesses. First, they're dependent on external power. Maybe because he built them knowing he couldn't leave his lab. There's no internal battery. That's why they won't work if they aren't plugged in. Second, and this is more than just a weakness, the legs are directly connected to his bones. Could be to minimize signal loss in the motor's output to the legs and the drive response from them. Either way,
use this!
Use bolts to attach load-bearing parts directly to his fingers, probably by mimicking surgical treatment for compound fractures and the like. But the end result is those legs and his body are fused together, and that appears to be how he's able to move them so precisely. But that also means that any shock to the legs would be delivered right to his bones by way of those bolts. The same is true if he encounters the corrosive metallic archaea. If the corrosive... ...to the exposed bolts, they'd reach the endoskeleton parts and eat through them too in the blink of an eye. The doctor's bones are full of holes to accommodate all the bolts. They're like sponges. If he were to lose the reinforcing part, even the tiniest bit of force or weight would snap his bones. So when I dangled those corrosive metallic archaea in front of him, he realized straight away what would happen. Life wouldn't be worth living if he lost those legs of his. I'd bet that is what the doctor would be like. I just helped him imagine what it would be like. Thanks to that, I got the information we needed without either. Probably already over the shock. The better you know your adversary, the easier it is for you to get to.
Flawless work. You never cease to amaze, boss. Good work.
See Skullface.
Where's the other?
Very close to you.
Do it yourself. Mission complete, boss.
Did it! Revenge!
Bye.
Anyone can give up his fight by laying down arms. But the feeling of holding a gun, that we'll never forget. Like our lost limbs, the sensation lingers.
Here she comes! Here she comes!
Rifles in missing hands. We stand tall on missing legs. We stride forward on the bones of our fallen. Then, and only then, are we alive. This pain is ours, and no one else's. The secret weapon we wield, out of sight. We will be stronger than ever. For our peace. Sahelanthropus will unleash that thirst unto the future. Those were his last words.
Kaz.
Pretentious to the end. Still. Doesn't feel like this is over. And I'll never be whole again.
Blind in the deepest night. Reaching out, grasping for a fleeting memory. All the thoughts keep piercing this broken mind. I fall, but I'm still standing motionless. Blood on my hands. Let no one.
Attention! Diamond Dogs! Even with Skullface dead, our brothers are unavenged. And the phantom pain he brought us lives on. Cypher is still out there. We know they've planted spies, parasites among us. Watch the man to your left, to your right. Assume nothing. Report everything. It's the only way to protect ourselves. From here on out. You. Be my eyes. The deadliest enemy's right here in our midst. And they will get no mercy.
Even with Skullface dead, our pain is still right with us. We need more strength. We need more men. Diamond Dogs needs to be bigger. Missions have come in too. We still have a long road ahead of us. Roger.
This is B-Quad. Arriving shortly at LZ. This is B-Quad. On station at LZ.